Welcome to Love and Responsibility LA. I'm Jennifer Havy, and our team is here to continue our mission to forming hearts and minds to love authentically. We are so excited tonight to have Edward Suri. He's the author of Men, Women, and the Mystery of Love, which many of us were a part of a book study for the last couple months. Reading this book was such a wonderful experience. And tonight we will be doing a recap and also a question and answer to follow. You will be able to submit your questions and we will try to get to you as many of the questions as we can tonight. We also have Father Matt Wheeler here, so I want to welcome him, and he's going to start us off with a prayer. Edward Suri, and also to open our hearts and minds. Hi, Father. How you doing?
Hey, everybody. I'm doing great. Thank you, Jen.
Thanks, Father. And Father, as you guys know, did the chapter summaries for each book. So if you haven't read it and you want to, you can go on the Facebook Love and Responsibility and look at each one of those chapter summaries before you read the chapter and even do a small group discussion. So we're going to have Dr. Edward Suri come on. He is actually a theologian, an author, and a well-known Catholic speaker who regularly goes on EWTN. He's written many best-selling books and a founding leader of FOCUS, Fellowship of Catholic University Students. Welcome, Dr. Edward Suri.
Thank you so much for having me.
Yeah, we are so happy to have you in Los Angeles. And so we're going to give it up to you. Father Matt's going to do a prayer for you. And then we are just excited to hear the recap of the book and why you wrote it and all that good stuff. So,
awesome. Well, let's begin with prayer. In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Heavenly Father, we give you thanks and praise for your goodness and the many gifts you freely bestow upon us, most especially the gift of yourself in your Son, Jesus Christ. Through the intercession of Pope St. John Paul II, I invoke your blessing upon Dr. Suri. Fill him with your wisdom as he shares with us this evening about your great plans for men and women, relationships, and marriage. Bless all of those participating tonight. Open their hearts to your truth, Heavenly Father, and fill them with the fire of your love. I make this prayer in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen. Thank you so much, Father Matt. Thanks for your support and all these efforts, too.
Oh, I love it. This is great. You're welcome.
All right, Dr. Suri. So if we can start with you. Why did you write this book? I just wanted to know that before we start with the recap. Where did this come from? I know JP2 is amazing, Love and Responsibility. Yeah, I just wanted to hear that a little.
Yeah, you know, it wasn't something I planned. You know, I was teaching at a small Catholic school in Kansas called Benedictine College. That's where FOCUS was born. And so I loved the school and all that. And I wanted to do a class on theology of the body. I'd studied love, responsibility, love, and theology of body a little bit, but I really wanted to like really unpack it for the students. And I remember I spent the Christmas break. This would have been, wow, maybe like 1999, 2000, very, you know, almost 20 years ago. I spent the Christmas break really going back and reading Love and Responsibility, which is the background of theology of the body. It's like the Old Testament, New Testament of TOB.
The foundation.
And I'd read Love and Responsibility before, but man, when I was reading it that winter break, I would go down to, there was this Benedictine Abbey and they had this crypt. And I went down to the chapel and I would read like 10 or 12 pages an hour, partly because the book's so thick, you know, challenging. Also, I was just so deeply moved personally by JP2's vision of what love is, what marriage is. I was newly married and I'm realizing this is the high standard of love. And I love my wife, but I'm not living that high standard of love. I also saw what a profound difference it was going to make for the many young people in their dating relationships, their friendships. And I just thought, man, this could really, it just sheds so much light. I don't know of another book that really helps us understand the dynamics between men and women, attraction, love, the pitfalls we fall into, the mistakes we make in relationships, why we make those mistakes. I mean, there is not another book out there that I think really gets at this more than JP2's Love and Responsibility. So when I ended up teaching my TOB class, I spent half the semester on Love and Responsibility. And then we got into TOB because we had the right foundations. And I think today a lot of people just jump to TOB and they're not really gonna appreciate what's going on there if we don't get this well. The last thing I'll say is this, is a friend of mine says, you know, TOB and L&R, they're awesome. They're both great. TOB is inspiring, but Love and Responsibility changes the way you wake up on Monday morning and treat your wife, or on Tuesday, and how you treat your beloved. And it's immediately applicable for all of our relationships. So I love it. And I ended up teaching on it for many years. I wrote a bunch of articles and eventually wrote the book. So.
Awesome. Well, thank you so much. I'm going to unmute and give me off and you go for a recap. And then hopefully we can do a Q&A after. We have a lot of people on that are ready to ask some questions. So.
Okay. So Jen, so I'll go for about 30 minutes and then Q&A. Is that the timing? Okay.
Yeah.
Awesome.
Thank you.
All right. Well, I understand we have people from all over California and all over the world joining us here. So welcome. Thanks for taking this time out in this busy Advent season in the month of December. But I'm so thrilled just to know that you all have been taking time out of your life to study JB2's wonderful wisdom. I'm going to give you a recap of some of the things I highlight in the book that I wrote, Men, Women, and the Mystery of Love. So this is the book that Jen and I were just talking about. And the first thing is, just to jump right in, I always start off with two really basic principles that we have to keep in mind. And that's how JB2 opens up his book. And the first one is what he calls the personalist principle. It's just, and I want you to bear with me, just give me like 3 minutes to just do some nuts and bolts. If you get these nuts and bolts down, then we can get to all the fun stuff about men, women, attraction, romance, and all that stuff. But we got to get these first two fundamental points right. First of all, personalist principle. Never treat another person merely as a means to an end. Don't treat another person as a means to an end. Every person has their own mind, their intellect, their reasoning power to think for themselves. They have their own free will to choose and make decisions for themselves. And if I just use someone for my own purposes, I'm really violating the beautiful order in which every person is made. So basically it means just don't use people. And I think most people get that. We shouldn't use people. The second principle JP2 talks about is the challenge we face. We might get in our heads, we shouldn't use people, but we live in an era that emphasizes utilitarianism. So that's the second key big word he uses at the beginning. Utilitarianism is simply the idea that emphasizes the usefulness of anything. Whenever I'm making a decision, I'm trying to decide, should I do this or this? I ask, what's more useful? What's more interesting for me? What's more profitable for me? What advantage do I get? What pleasure do I get out of this? I'm always looking at what I get out of it. And let's be honest, in life, you need to apply that kind of principle to many decisions. If I'm going to make an investment in the stock market, I might make an investment based on, well, what's going to give the best return on my investment. That's a utilitarian decision. That's good. If I'm a college student, I'm taking classes at the university, I have to sign up for spring 2021 semester, and I got to figure out, okay, well, I need this class to graduate. Well, I'm going to make a utilitarian decision and make that class. It's okay to do that. The problem is that when we look at everything in our world today with a utilitarian lens, we'll start to even treat the people in our life with a utilitarian lens. We'll start to look at them more in terms of what I get out of them. It leads me to value the people in my life, my friends, my roommate, my family, a boyfriend, a girlfriend. I look at them more in terms of how useful they are to me. What do I get out of them? What benefit do I get from them? What advantage do I get from them? What pleasure, fun times do I get from them? And the sad part is, once I cease to experience the benefit from them or some advantage from them or pleasure from them, then they're no longer that interesting to me. So if I can't do business deals with them, I was nice to them, but I'm probably not going to keep being friends with them if they're not in the same business I am anymore. And if this person is no longer, we don't have the same interests anymore, then I'm probably not going to hang out with them. I'm not really committed in these kinds of friendships. I'm not really committed to you. I'm just committed to what I get out of you. You give me some benefit, you give me some pleasure, you give me some fun times. And that's always dangerous, and that always ends up in relationships of great disappointment, disillusionment. So that's just a little background. Let's get to the fun stuff though, okay? I wanna get to the fun stuff. So let's talk about attraction. I wanna talk about attraction. What goes on when boy meets girl? That initial spark. So just picture, I know it's a COVID time, so maybe people aren't hanging out at coffee houses as much as they used to, but you can remember those days when you'd hang out at a Starbucks or your local coffee house, whatever that is. And just imagine there's a young man sitting there on a Saturday morning. He's reading a book and he's sipping on his coffee. And all of a sudden, this beautiful girl walks in with all of her friends. And this guy is immediately drawn to her beauty. And she's like, oh, wow, she is really good looking. And so he looks down and takes a sip of his coffee. Then he looks up to see where she is. He looks down to read a line from his book, and then he looks over there and sees where she is. Now he is just drawn to her physical appearance, but it's more than a physical thing, because he's also drawn to her personality. You see, he has seen this gal here on Saturday mornings with her friends before, which is why he's probably here on this Saturday morning again right now. But he notices her warm personality. She's really joyful. She laughs a lot. So there's something more than just the good looks. There's something of her personality that she's attracted to as well. You see, these kinds of attractions happen all the time. And you don't have to like really work hard at it and think about it. It just happens. You know, you don't have to wake up on Wednesday morning and go, please, please help me to be attracted to someone. No, it just happens. You know, you're at the checkout line. You see a beautiful girl walk by. Ding, there's some attraction. There's a gal at the young adult group and they have a special mass. And then there's some new man that showed up at the young adult mass this week. And he's really attractive. And she starts thinking about him. And, you know, she can't wait to come to the young adult mass next week. You know, so these things just happen. There's this attraction that happens that we don't plan. And it's something physical, but it's also something more. It could be also something related to just the person's personality. So let's summarize then. What is that attraction? What is that attraction that's going on? John Paul II says that we're drawn to the sexual value of the person of the opposite sex, the sexual value of that person. He highlights that every person has value in and of themselves just for who they are, as a human being made in the image and likeness of God, as a son and daughter of God. Every person has value, but what we tend to notice first is the physical appearance and their personality, because those are things that are more readily accessible. When I walk down the streets of New York City, I don't happen to notice, wow, look at that soul. Because I can't see the soul. But I might walk down the streets of New York City and go, wow, what an attractive person that is. Like, in other words, those are the things that we notice more immediately. And those are called the sexual values, John Paul II says. And he says there's two aspects of those sexual values. There's the physical qualities of the person, and then there's the psychological qualities. The physical qualities are just the body of the other person, their physical features, their good looks. But then there's also what he calls the psychological qualities, and that's the masculinity of the man, the femininity of the woman, and there's an emotional attraction to those psychological qualities. So I want to make sure you're following this here. So there's a physical attraction, a sensual attraction to the physical features, the body of the other person. And then there's an emotional attraction, a sentimental emotional attraction to the psychological qualities of the other person. And those psychological qualities are the masculinity of the man or the femininity of the woman. And JP2 doesn't really elaborate at all what that is. I like to think of it as simply the mystery of the opposite sex. There's something about the mystery of the feminine for a man, and there's something of the mystery of this opposite sex, this opposite kind of a way of being human, of masculinity that's attractive there. So the mystery of the opposite sex. So you got that. So you got physical attraction, emotional attraction, and that's what's drawing us toward other people. And these attractions just happen all the time, and they're not bad. They're actually really good. God made us this way. And they're meant to draw us not just to the qualities of the other person. They're meant to draw us to the actual person who possesses those qualities. Now, this is an important point. I want to make sure you follow this here. That these qualities, the physical features or the psychological qualities, they don't exist in the abstract. They only exist in concrete human persons. And so when we notice someone's good looks, we notice their masculine and femininity, it's meant to lead us to the person that has those good looks or those feminine and masculine features. These qualities don't exist in the abstract. So for example, you know, there's no man that wakes up on Thursday morning and just says, I need blonde. Oh, I just need some blonde. I'm just so attracted to blonde. No, he may be very attracted to a particular woman who has blonde hair, but he's not attracted to just blonde. Same thing, there's no woman that wakes up on a Friday morning and just says, I need masculinity. I gotta go find some masculinity. I need some masculinity. No, she might be attracted to a particular man that possesses masculine qualities, but she's not attracted to to masculinity in the abstract. So all of these qualities reside in people, and God gave us these qualities because they signal out to others and we notice that, but it's meant to let us look not just at your body, but to look at you so that you can be known for who you are, that you can be loved for who you are, not just those qualities. You know, because all of us know deep down, I'm so much more than just my body, just more than my physical appearance. And even if someone has good looks, I'm more than that. There's much more to me than my body. And so I think that's what we want to keep in mind, is that the danger in relationships is when we reduce the other person to just those qualities. I mean, that's why poor Ed Sheeran just gets it so wrong. You know, he gets it so wrong. I'm in love with your body. I'm in love with the shape of you. And though my heart's kind of in it too, it's really just about your body. He comes out just so crassly and says it, you know, that I'm in love with your body. I'm not really in love with you. I mean, a woman longs to be loved for who she is, not just for her body. And what our modern world, and I'm not picking on Ed Sheeran, I'll just say his song is far from perfect. Let's just say that. But this is our sexualized world, you know, that it just views things, you know, in this way. We just view other people as things, as objects, and I reduce it to a body for my satisfaction, for me to look at, for me to touch, for me to get pleasure from. I don't really see you, I see just your body. That's why JP2 says, that when we fall into this kind of sensuality, we're blind to the person. Ed Sheeran in that song is just blind. He does not see the other person. He just sees a body. And you long to be loved for so much more than your body. You want to be loved for who you are. So that's the danger of a utilitarian attitude applied to relationships, is that we end up kind of looking at other people more in terms of the body and what I get out of them. Another thing I would say, you know, with this is there's a bunch of things I'd love to get into. I'll just briefly mention this, that what's going on in the sexual sphere of human beings is different than what's happening in the sexual sphere of animals. You know, animals, it's just like a reflex mode of action. You know, they just act on sexual instinct, you know, so just like reflex. There's no thinking going on. It's just like, it just acts. It's kind of like when you go to the doctor's office and they take that little metal or the little triangle thing and they hit your knee and your knee just pops out. That's what's going on in the animal sphere. There's no deliberation. And you say that not just about sex, you say about their other appetites. You take a big hungry dog and you put that dog, you know, hasn't eaten in many days, and you bring that dog into a building and you put a big juicy steak in front of that dog. What's that dog going to do? Is that dog going to go, oh, wait, I'll let the lady dogs go first. No, dog's just going to devour it. Dog's not going to say, oh, wait, it's a Friday in Lent, I can't have meat. No, the dog just acts on its appetites. That's what a dog does. Human being doesn't do that. At least we're not meant to do that. Same thing like a cat in heat, going to the sexual sphere. If there's a cat in heat, female cat in heat, that female cat doesn't go around the neighborhood interviewing different male cats, discerning the relationship. No, the female cat just acts, you know, and it's just instinct. We as human beings are not meant to be a slave to our appetites and to our sexual passions. We are meant to rise above them. We because we're given a mind to think for ourselves, as I mentioned earlier, and a will to choose for ourselves, so that we actually can take those initial sparks of attraction and allow them to lead us to either love the person as a friend, as a brother or sister in Christ, a son or daughter of God, or I can allow that passion to lead me to just crave that person for what I get out of them and treat them like a piece of meat and I'm a dog and I'm just acting on instinct. So what happens in the sexual sphere spontaneously? These things just happen all the time. But what we do with that initial spontaneous response demands great responsibility. Will I allow this to lead to authentic friendship, or allow this initial attraction to lead me to use? Now, there's two different ways we can use people. One is in the physical realm. It's in the sexual realm, when we may use the other person physically, sensually, sexually. That's one way. But I would rather talk about another way. And it's not that this isn't important. It's just that there's a lot of other people that talk about sensuality. So for our short time together, I'm going to use our time to talk about what happens in the emotional sphere, because I think most people get, we can use people sexually. You know, I'm just in it for the sex. I don't really care about you. You know, I do care about you and I'll have sex with you, but I'm only interested in you and I'm committed to you until something better comes along, you know, premarital sex and all that. And so again, a lot of chastity speakers, you can listen to all them on that topic. I want to talk about what's going on emotionally, because we can use people without ever touching them. We can use them without ever having a lustful thought. We can use them in the emotional sphere. And this is where we end up in a lot of problems in dating relationships. Sentimentality. Let's talk about this. John Paul II says, love is often reduced to feelings. He wrote this in the 1950s Poland. I can't imagine what he'd say today. But love is often reduced to feelings. That if I want to know, am I in love? I gauge what feelings do I have? Feelings are the measure for love. Now, don't get me wrong. Feelings can be a part of a relationship. And you know, the ideal relationship isn't one in which there's no feelings. Like I say to my wife, hey, Beth, I love you. I'm committed to you. I'll always be there for you. I'll die for you. But I have no feelings for you. That's not the ideal marriage. You know, feelings give us a sense that we're connecting with the other person. I'm entering into their emotional sphere. So feelings are all great. But they're not the measure of love. Because JPG points out they're often misleading. In fact, he comes right out and says in Love and Responsibility, he says, feelings are blind. Feelings are blind. They're not concerned with truth. I mean, think about it. I don't know if many of you have any theology or philosophy background, but even if you haven't, I bet you can get this answer right, okay? There's different powers that we have in our soul. We have the intellect, the mind to think. And we have the will to choose, and we have our passions and emotions. Which aspect of my soul has the responsibility to discern truth? If I want to know if something is true, do I turn to my mind? Do I turn to my feelings, my emotions? Do I turn to my will? What am I turning to? It's the mind. Like if I ask you, what's 2 + 2? Are you using your mind? Are you using your will? Or are you using your feelings? 2 + 2 = 4. But imagine if you're in math class, say at some university, and they're reviewing basic math, 2 + 2 = 4. And some kid in the back says, wait, professor, I disagree with that. I disagree that 2 + 2 = 4, because for me, 2 + 2 just feels like 5. It just feels that way for me. You know, 5 just has those two straight lines and then the curve. You just go, that guy's crazy, right? No. Use your mind to figure out truth. So if you want to discern the truth about your relationship, if you want to discern the truth, am I loving this person? Does this person love me? Are we a good match? Is this the kind of person I should marry? You don't consult your feelings for that. Feelings can maybe in the background, might be a part of it, but you need to use your mind. You got to ask questions of the mind, not the emotions. I mean, you don't want to just say, you know, oh, you know, he's just really good looking and he's fun to be with. I mean, that's great. You get warm feelings when you're with this guy. That's fine. But you want to ask questions. Is this the kind of guy that's going to lay down his life for you? That's not a question of feelings. You have to use your mind and discern this man's character. If this is a guy that just plays video games for several hours every day, use your mind and realize that's probably not the guy that is gonna be easy for him to lay down his life for me, because he's entertaining himself all the time. He's training his will to just be entertained, to be amused. So it's not easy for him to get out of himself and sacrifice to serve you and your future children. It's not going to be easy for him to do that. Doesn't mean he can't do it every once in a while, but it's not a habit. It's not a virtue. That's a question of the mind. That has nothing to do with the feelings you get when he texts you. Same thing. You know, you don't want to just go, oh man, she is just so good looking in that dress. Oh, she's so beautiful. I mean, I'm grateful she's beautiful. That's wonderful. But you got to ask the question, is this the kind of woman that can carry a lot of weight in life? And I don't mean just physical weight. That may happen if you get pregnant. I'm talking about the shoulder a lot of responsibility. You know, if she may be really good looking and all and really fun, but can she shoulder a lot of responsibility? Because being married, raising children, takes a lot out of you. It's incredibly demanding. One of the things my wife and I, we've been doing a lot of, one of the blessings of COVID has been less traffic. And the other blessing in the Sri family life has just been, I've been able to do a lot of ministry with my wife back like the early days. My wife Beth was one of the first female focused missionaries. And, you know, normally she doesn't get to travel with me because we have 8 kids and, you know, who's going to watch the kids if she's not home with them, you know? So she normally doesn't get to give talks with me and things and all, but because of COVID and things like this, we've been asked to do things for dioceses and young adult groups and things, events going on around the world. It's been so fun. But one of the things we really love to talk about is the realities of marriage. Not, oh, the beautiful TOB vision of marriage. And I love that stuff. I teach that. But the reality, how hard, how demanding marriage is. Few people talk about the realities of marriage. And to prepare yourself for the realities of marriage that you're going to face someday, or if you're married now and you're wanting to prepare yourself for the challenges that will come in marriage, in every marriage, in every family life, it takes a lot more than good feelings. You need to use your mind and make a judgment. Are you ready for this? Is this other person ready for this? Are you a good fit? Those are questions of the mind. The sad part is so much of our culture just gets us to think of love as feelings, right? Like all the average love songs out there, right? It's all about feelings, you know? It's like, you know, I can't live without you. And you're like, yes, you can. You live 23 years without this person. You really can live without this person. All I need is you. No, you need oxygen, water, and many other things. It's so hyper-sentimental, so emotional. And we breathe this stuff in from all the shows we watch on Amazon Prime, Netflix, all the music we listen to. It conditions us to think love is about what I get out of this other person. Love is about all the feelings I get from them, the emotions, that emotional side of love, or it's all about the sexual pleasure, the Ed Sheeran love. Like, I'm in love with your body and what your body can do for me to give me sexual release. That's what I love. Yeah, that's love. Love is physical pleasure, or it's just emotional. And our culture exploits us in this. I'm going to get to what real love is in a moment. We're going to get to that. That'll be the climax of where we go. But one thing I want to highlight is that with this emotional, hyper-sentimental understanding of love today, it gets us to idealize other people. And that's the point John Paul II makes, is that what we do is we often, as a rule, we exaggerate the other person's value. Their value grows enormously. When we fall in love and we allow our emotions to sweep us away, he says, what happens is the value of a beloved grows enormously as a rule out of all proportion to his or her real value. So we happen to notice a little quality, we just suddenly exaggerate their quality so much. I mean, these things happen all the time, right? You know, so again, picture that gal at the young adult group and there's that handsome man at mass, but let's say this mass, they actually had a social afterwards. And so she's talking to different people, but she gets to talk to this guy for 20 minutes, you know, and she's all like, this is amazing. We connected really well for 20 minutes and she can't stop thinking about this guy. She starts praying for this guy. She starts thinking about the wedding dress. And I know your ladies are laughing right now because you know it's true. You've done that. You've met a guy and you've had maybe a 20-minute conversation. And sometimes you've allowed your mind to go to the wedding dress. I only know this because I've had hundreds of women tell me from all over the United States, overseas, from Dubai to Australia, yeah, we've done that. So I know that, you know, that you can start immediately. You just exaggerate, wow, this what this could be. And you just met the guy for 20 minutes. Guys, the message is be careful, 20 minutes, you might, no, I'm just kidding. but the point is, We do this, and it's not just girls, guys do it too. I went to college with a guy that had a lot of ups and downs with girls, and he'd fall in love with a girl and then they'd break up around 4 months, fall in love with another girl, break up. And it was just like this pattern, but it always was the same thing. He'd meet this girl and he'd be so excited about this girl and he'd be idealizing her. And it was always some line he would use. It was so pathetic. It was so sad. The poor guy, he would just always say, oh no, she's really fun. And she's athletic. Yeah, because he was really into sports, so he needed someone that was athletic. She's athletic, and, you know, she's really kind, and she's caring. And then here was the line. He said, "She reminds me of my mom." And every time he did the mom line, it's, oh, not the mom line again. Come on. You know, but you can tell what he's doing is he's idealizing this person. And he would do it over and over again. You meet like one person, and then you have a conversation with them, and then you find out they have maybe 3.5 of your favorite qualities, you know, that you're looking for in the ideal spouse. And you wrote those top, you know, 10 qualities you're looking for, and you wrote them and you put them on a Bible on one of your retreats. And now you meet someone that's got maybe 3.5 of those qualities, and then you exaggerate them to make them like, wow, they're like Pier Giorgio, blessed Pier Giorgio, really manly, really cool. And I can just see us getting married on top of a mountain peak. He'll have that pipe. It'll be awesome. You know, like we just start exaggerating, you know, what our relationship is going to be like. And it's not corresponding to reality. Why do we tend to do this? We tend to do this because we're longing with all our heart to find someone, to find that perfect someone that's going to fulfill all of these emotional needs that we have. And we think that this other person's going to do it. That's what JP2 actually says. JP2 points out that's why we tend to exaggerate the person's qualities, is that we long to find someone. So I make them to be this amazing because I get a rush of emotions from that. You know, this is the kind of thing we do, especially social media has amplified that. I've had many young adults. One of the things I did in the new version of the book is I interviewed young adults and young married couples, so both single and married, from all over the world. So I talked to people from all over the world about their struggles and joys and dating relationships and what they learned from JP2's Love and Responsibility. And what a number of them said was this, I'll quote one, you know, when you're looking at someone on social media, looking at their profile, looking at what they're posting, their stories, they said, your brain can't help but fill in the gaps. You create a character in your head, but it's not the real person. Isn't that what we do? We just kind of, you know, just fill in gaps and you just make this person to be so amazing, but you don't really know them. You're just looking at them on their social media, met them once, and you think you're getting this amazing picture, but it's not real. And then our hearts rise and get excited, you know? And so I keep feeding this idealism. I keep filling in those gaps because the more I make them to be so amazing, the more rush of emotion I get. But when I'm doing this, I'm not falling in love with the real person. I'm falling in love with this ideal image I created for myself. And those relationships are always going to end in disappointment and disillusionment because that person cannot match up to what I really expected them to be. I'm going to start to notice their faults. I'm going to start to notice their weaknesses, their bad hair days, whatever. I'm going to notice things, and they're not going to give me that rush of emotion. So I'll end up, you know, breaking the relationship because I'm so frustrated with this person I was so in love with, but they're no longer, you know, feeding those emotional rushes, those romantic feelings that I'm longing for. All right. I mentioned that I would highlight as well authentic love. So I want to get to that now. And that's what I'm going to close with in the last 5 minutes here. I want to highlight JP2 later in his work, Love and Responsibility. I cover it in the middle part of the book. Is he talks about the difference between an immature love and a mature love. An immature love, he says, is inward looking. It's when I'm just looking at inwardly and I'm looking at what pleasure, sensual pleasure do I get from this person and their body? And what emotional pleasure do I get from the rush of emotions from their psychological quality? So it's physical. I'm just looking inside. I'm looking at the feelings I get out of this other person. And JP2 says, that's just not love. That's not love. That's, you're just having a psychological experience. That's what he says. You're just experiencing these feelings inside. And real love is, again, isn't about feelings. What's the definition of love? Quoting the great St. Thomas Aquinas, the Catholic Church officially teaches in the Catechism, what is love? To will the good of the other. That's what love is, to will the good of the other, to seek what's best for somebody else. That's what real love is. It's outward looking. I'm seeking what's best for this other person. They're seeking what's best for me. It's not about my feelings. It's about laying down my life and serving the good of this other person. And what do we need to have this authentic love? We need Self-giving and responsibility. What is self-giving? It's when I choose to make myself a gift to others. I use my life not for my own purposes. I'm not grasping and looking for others to fulfill my need. I'm looking out and loving others in the sense of willing the good of the other. But I have to tell you, my friends, to will the good of the other, to really love, not anyone can do that. It requires great virtue. You know, anybody can say, I love you. Some people might sincerely mean it, but there are only few people that actually have the character, the moral character, the inner strength of virtue to be able to love you. See, love is so much more than feelings. I mean, let me give an example here. If I told you, true story here, when I was a kid, my dad would sometimes go on business trips and he'd take me with him. And I got to go with him and, you know, go to his conferences, and it was great. I loved airplanes. I was so fascinated by airplanes. And to this day, I get to travel a lot. I love airplanes. There's something really fun about airplanes. If I told you I am so passionate about airplanes, I love airplanes, and I heard you needed to fly to Chicago because you were going to go back and visit family over Christmas, and I told you, oh, let me fly you. I'll fly you there. I love airplanes. I have strong feelings about airplanes. I am passionate about airplanes. Would you get in an airplane with me in the cockpit? No way. I don't have the skills of a pilot. Same thing. My dad was a surgeon, and he used to, you know, show me pictures of his surgery. He showed me anatomy books. And if I told you I was so passionate about surgery, I just get all these warm childhood memories and good feelings about surgery. And I heard you needed surgery. And I said, oh, great. Come on this table. I'll perform the surgery for you because I have a lot of feelings about surgery. Would you ever get on the operating table with me as your surgeon? I'm not that kind of doctor. I don't think so. I don't have the skills of a surgeon. This is all common sense, right? You don't get into an airplane with a guy that doesn't have the skills of a pilot. You don't jump on a surgery table with the guy that doesn't have the skills of a surgeon. And yet, how many people today jump into dating relationships, marriages, build families without ever asking the question of virtue? It's all about, well, we just feel, you know, this works out. You know, no. Virtue is the skill. It's the skill that gives you the ability to live the art of living. To live the art of living well, to live friendship well, to live dating relationships well, to live marriage well, to live family life well. You need a lot more than feelings. You need virtue. Virtue gives you the freedom to love. And this is a key point that many people that get so excited about TOB, they don't talk about this point. And yet it's so fundamental to JP2. So fundamental to JP2. If you want to live your relationships well, you have to grow in virtue. So right now, I want to encourage you all, whether you're married and you're starting to build a strong marriage, or you are dating someone or engaged and thinking about married, or you're just single and hoping to be married someday, I want to encourage you, one of the best things you can do to prepare for your marriage, in addition to, of course, growing in your own faith life and prayer life, of course, the second thing would be intentionally go after virtue right now. Because just because you get married, you put on a nice wedding dress, a nice tuxedo, and you have a wonderful sacramental ceremony, the grace of that sacrament is built on nature. And right now, I want to talk to all of you single people right now. Right now, you are in marriage prep. You might not be engaged. You might not even be dating someone. But right now, you are in marriage prep. In other words, the way you're living now, the way you live with your coworkers, the way you live with your roommates, the way you live in community with your friends, you are forming the habits, the patterns for friendship that you are going to take into your marriage for better or for worse. So right now, practice living virtuous friendship where you are thinking about serving others and not yourself. Practice laying down your life. Practice serving and being committed to the young adult group, to serving the poor, to your parish, whatever. And I know COVID's a little crazy right now, so it may be hard to do these things. But that's one thing my wife and I, we've been advising. People always ask us, Dr. Shree, what advice do you and Beth have, you know, for us if we ever want to be married someday? And that's what we always say, is be committed to serving others consistently. Not when you want, not when it's convenient for you, not when it fits into your schedule. No. You set a time. Every Sunday, we're going to serve here. Or every Friday night, we're going to serve here. I don't care if my favorite team is in the World Cup. I don't care what's going on. I'm going to serve. Why? because that's what marriage and family life is all about. It's about serving precisely when you don't feel like it, precisely when it's inconvenient, at 2:30 in the morning when a kid is just screaming and you are exhausted. That's not a convenient time. Oh, can I volunteer to serve? There's no volunteer. You just get up and go do it. And right now you need to form the habits of serving and laying down your life and doing hard things consistently, not when you want to, but you are consistent because it's faithfulness. That's what real love is all about. Willing the good of the other and being faithful to that. Not willing the good of the other when it's interesting, when it's convenient, when you have warm feelings. Will you be faithful in prayer? Will you be faithful in service? That's what Jesus is asking for all of us. And I'll pause there to take some Q&A. So thank you all so much. Great to be with you all.
Ooh, that was great. Thank you. No, you should have saw some of the comments like, this is fire. This is awesome. So thank you so much, Dr. Sri. So let's get into these questions. All right, Anna, I just want to ask, what advice will you give to a person who fears too much about marriage, although she feels that marriage is her vocation? Thanks in advance.
Oh, I'd love to hear more what Anna fears. So yeah, I'm not sure what exactly she's fearing. I'm guessing there's a fear because it's a commitment. Sometimes people fear that just that idea that I'm locked in, I'm committed. I'm fear that I maybe marry the wrong person, or I fear I'm just not up for the task. I'm fear it's going to be so hard. So there's a lot of different fears that go into it. I wish my wife were here with me. She'd be great on this topic as well.
We'll do that next time. We should have you together. Yeah.
Oh yeah. We would love that. So if you ever want to do it, we love like do a Q&A on what is marriage really like? And we're totally honest, you know, just cause I'm like, I think some people think Dr. Sri's a theologian and he wrote this book on TOB. They must sit around the dinner table and just talk about TOB all the time. It's like, no, our life is messy. Our marriage is messy. Our family life is messy. And that's the beauty of it, that God comes and meets us and all that. But anyway, back to Anna's question, you know, I would say, you know, there's some, I want to hit it from a couple different angles, not knowing the source of the fear. Sometimes there is a fear that's a little deeper, that it's rooted in some wounds from our past. And that could be maybe like my wife, if she were here, she would talk all about being a child of divorce. She is involved in a lot of ministries for adult children of divorce, and how much coming from a broken home when you're younger or in high school or even in early college, you don't realize how much that affects you. It's just like, well, like she always says, you know, I have brown hair, curly hair, blue eyes, and I'm a child of divorce. And just kind of like, whatever, you know, it's just like just a fact. You don't realize how much it affects you until you enter into serious relationships of your own. And she'll be very honest and talk about how much that's been a trial in our marriage. And she'll talk about there's certain things that I do that trigger her that like it maybe wouldn't trigger someone else, but because of her past, it's hard. And she'll talk about how she went to counseling and all that. So I share that because if there is some kind of wound in your life, it could be abuse, it could be like dysfunctional family life. It doesn't have to be physical abuse, just like, you know, psychological kind of like dysfunction in a family life. Or you did grow up in a broken home. Those are real wounds. And that would cause some fear. Don't be afraid to go to counseling. Find good Catholic counseling. Talk to Jen and Father Matt. They can point you in the right direction. But God wants to bring that healing. And the more you can do some of that healing before you enter into marriage, the more your marriage will be blessed. You'll probably need more counseling in marriage because more stuff will come out. But that's okay too. You know. So I would bring, that's the more serious thing. In a more general way, you know, the fear of marriage, you know, again, sometimes is I'm afraid of commitment. And that's in the spirit of our age. I don't like to commit. I like to just be free in the sense of I want to do what I want. I tell the story in the book, if you all went through it, about, you know, like we can't even commit to like what we're going to do on a Friday night. You know, somebody asks you, hey, do you want to do something Friday night? We're like, let me get back to you. Well, you're free and you like this person and you're your friends. Why don't you just go Friday night with your friends? Well, I'm afraid something better might come up. I don't want to have FOMO, you know? So like we can't even commit a Friday night in our culture. It's no wonder that we're afraid of bigger commitments like marriage. And so maybe like there, it's actually acting against those kinds of smaller little commitments and saying, I'm just going to be committed. And that will help build up that, you know, moral muscle inside in your will to be able to be more open to committing to bigger things. So hope that helps. Give you a couple little things.
Yeah, definitely. And you can always reach out. Bishop started a Divine Mercy Clinic, so we have Catholic counselors, and we also do prayer teams for Unbound, so deliverance. So if anybody needs prayer, and awesome. We have a priest for spiritual direction too. Yvette, do you have more book recommendations for, not, in addition to Love and Responsibility, to learn more about personal relationships?
Do I have more book recommendations? Okay, well, JP2, he's the master, and Love and Responsibility is number one. My book helps unpack that to make it a little bit more accessible. Oop, did I lose you? Uh-oh.
You're here. We see ya.
Oh, okay. You know what? on relationships. Okay, so I have... I'm looking over here, a number of things that I would recommend, you know, on my mind. I know my good friend Jason Everett has done a lot of good stuff, particularly around the realm of chastity. You know, he tends to write for a younger audience, you know, a little bit more. I mean, I think it's accessible and applicable to all areas. So if you look up the works of Jason Everett, chastityproject.com, there's a lot of good resources on that front. You know, I don't know if this person's talking in the single realm, you know, there's a lot of books out there that I would say, honestly, like some of it are, they're like little trite books, you know, like, oh, here's seven things to do and have a great relationship. I just always balk against those. And that may be my own temperament. So if you get something out of them, go for it. But sometimes I find them, I was just talking, my daughter is here. She's 20 years old. She's back from college. And she was talking about some of these other books about like this. And she goes, they often just don't really offer that much. It's not that helpful. You know, like they're kind of good at saying, don't do these things, but they don't actually offer a game plan for, you know, living it out. And that's where I really do think I was hitting this point at the end about the virtues. I would rather than read a book on how to have good relationships, I would rather be reading on how I can grow in virtue. I think that is a great, because that's what you need. You need virtue to live those friendships well. So I'll give you a recommendation. Easy book to read, great, filled with stories about virtue. Donald DeMarco wrote a book, a little while ago. It's called The Heart of Virtue by Ignatius Press. It's published by Ignatius Press. Donald DeMarco, The Heart of Virtue, easy, accessible. You can read it, you know, a high schooler could read this book. Filled with lots of stories from movies, history, art, literature. A lot of saint stories in it of exemplifying the virtues. I find that book to be really a nice, easy introduction to the virtues. You can go to my website. I've got a lot of free articles about different virtues. I'm working on a book right now, so I'll on it. But some of my articles are posted there, and they're for free. You can go to my website, edwardsri.com, edwardsri.com. That would be another one that would be really good on that. So, there you go.
Awesome. Okay, what do you do when you're attracted to someone to not degrade them to only their sexual value?
Yeah, look them in the eye. That's one of the easiest things. Like if they're right in front of you, like make eye contact. You are looking at the person in the eye, you're talking to them. Okay, now let's say you're not like, in, you know, they're just across the room or they're over there or whatever, they're walking by. Watch your eyes. I mean, I'll say this is especially true for men. Men are more sensual, John Paul II says, but it doesn't mean women aren't. And our women are much ever more exposed to pornography and other things today. And so women need to be careful on this as well. Don't allow yourself, your eyes, to start looking at sexual body parts. You know, I think that's dangerous. Like you want to really just train. I think if there's a great story of St. Aloysius Gonzaga, who he grew up, he was raised in a very wealthy family in Florence, the Medici family. And there was a lot of like, new kind of art. And you'd see immodest images on the walls that were painted there. And he just kept his eyes, he guarded his eyes, made a covenant with his eyes. And so I think that's just really important. And especially for men, but I think it's true for women too, but especially for men, the training to look at other people the right way is also when you're just at home and you're with your phone and you're on screens. Like you don't look at those ads on the side. Don't go keep clicking over here. You know, be really guarded on what you're doing there, because you're developing a habit that you then take. If you're clicking and keep looking at other people as objects on screens, then when you're with them, you're going to look at them as objects. And quite frankly, you're building up habits you'll take into your marriage. You'll start looking at your spouse as an object. And then you won't be able to give your heart fully to your spouse because you'll be with other people and you'll be looking at them as objects. And so you want to really work on this. So I think a lot of the work begins even when you're not with actual concrete human beings in front of you, but you're looking at images on screens.
Yes, so good. Even people knowing their name, that's a big one too, right? Like a person has a name, they're a person. Okay, from Adam, how long should one wait for their boyfriend or girlfriend to make a decision on marriage before moving on?
Okay, yeah. So I'm assuming what Adam means here is like you're talking about it, but you haven't decided about it. But you're ready. And the other person is hesitant. You know, every relationship is different. It's different when you're 18 versus when you're 30, you know, so I don't want to give any clear rule on this. But I think, you know, if you've been dating a while, you know, I mean, if you're like 2 months or 3 months in and you're impatient, that's probably too early, you know, but if it's gone, I don't know, 2 years or so, like what more do you need to discern? What more do you need to really figure out? If you're, you know, especially if you've lived in the same city and you've spent a lot of time together, you know, if you're living in different cities, a long distance relationship, well then, if it's really serious, you're both serious about discerning the relationship at a deeper level, then try to move together, you know, to not live together, but move to the same city, you know, to be in the relationship. That would be one reason I could see waiting. There could be other reasons of waiting, like I need to finish graduate school for financial reasons, whatever. That could be too. But in general, I don't know what more you learn after about 18 months or 2 years of dating. I'm not sure.
Disillusionment and idealization through sentimentality.
You know, you cut out, you froze on my end. I'm sorry about that. Can you say the question again?
What are some tips so you don't fall into disillusionment or idealization through sentimentality? What are some tips?
Yeah, practical tips. That very thankful that question came up. Thank you, because I always have to give the don't freak out lecture here. That's what I'm going to tell you now. So when people hear me talk about this, many people have this freak out moment. They're like, oh my goodness, I'm idealizing all the time. Oh my goodness, I don't know. Should I break up with this boy? Am I just like, am I idealizing? And I say, it's okay, calm down. You know, the fact that you're realizing that you idealize is good. You're living in truth now. You're aware of a weakness. And we all have the weakness. And so it's okay. We're fallen. So our emotions are going to tend to exaggerate. That's what JP2 said. So don't freak out. I think first thing is, as I mentioned, being aware of that tendency to idealize, so that I get the rush of emotions, that most of the world isn't even aware of it. And so what happens is they're just a slave to their emotions. You now have come to an awareness from studying JP2, reading the book, listening to this talk. You have an awareness. That's half the battle. So thank Jesus. That's the first thing you should do. Thank you, Jesus. I'm learning about this. Then second thing, ask Jesus. Now, Jesus, help me to temper, help me to moderate that emotional rise, that idealism, you know, and just realize that you're going to do it. And then a third thing I would say is, if you catch yourself doing it, then just say, oh, I'm not going to just let my mind just, you know, go that way, you know. But I think the biggest thing, fourth one, is talk to people. Talk to people that love you and know you, you know, good friend, a spiritual director, and admit to them, I probably idealize. I'm looking to, can you give me a sense? Like, what do you think about this other person? You know, and I think that's helpful, because when you actually have to talk to someone else about it, you're not just living in your own little ideals and your own emotions, you know? And then finally talk to Jesus about it. Tell Jesus, Jesus, I know I'm going to idealize. Give me the grace to temper that I'm not swept away. Give me the grace to see the truth. He'll be faithful if you talk to him about it.
Yeah, pray for that virtue. I know, especially go to friends who are more rational than you, right? All right. This is a good one. Is there such thing as the one, Dr. Sri? Is there such thing as the one?
Oh, this question always comes up. And my first answer is, in my marriage, yes, absolutely. She's the one. I want to, this is like the third time this question's come up. It does come up periodically, but I'm hearing it more. I think that this younger generation has that question more in their mind. So I want to ponder it. So how about that? I'm going to say this is, so I'll give you an initial response, but my mind might change on it later tonight as I think about it even some more. I do know from the book of Tobit, you do get a sense in that story that God has a plan. He has someone that the God has chosen for Tobias, you know? So I look at that. I look at it in Revelation. I just see, you know, that's God's inspired word. I think there is a plan. I think God does have the one that's there. I think that we might miss things and God can write straight with crooked lines and find someone else for us. That may not have been what he intended originally, you know? So when I say there is the one, don't freak out and go, oh my goodness, I missed it or whatever. What if I, you know, that God, there is the one that he originally had planned. That would have been maybe the best thing, but that doesn't mean that you're lost and you're going to have a horrible marriage or whatever. God may provide another. Does that make sense? Like, in other words, God can still work with our, he can write straight with our crooked lines. And last thing I'll say about this is, how do you know when you find the one? I want to give you the secret. This is the advice so many people told me when I was single and I asked all these married, good Catholic married couples, how did you know? How did you know? And they all said the same thing. It was amazing. Are you ready? Here's the secret. Ready? How do you know when you find the one? You just know. That was the advice I got. And I go, that's not helpful. But all I can tell you is I remember when my wife and I, we had our first like conversation about our relationship. So we were friends, we're working together in ministry and focus. And then it was a late night conversation and it comes out, all right, we're going to start dating. I remember the next morning I woke up and all of a sudden I just knew. I remember thinking, oh, I've got to eat healthier. I've got to take better care of my health. And I'm like, where is this coming from? And it was all of a sudden I had this sense of responsibility to care for Beth and care for our future children. I was like, whoa, I kind of just knew right away. So I hope that you'll come and experience that moment at some point.
Yeah, maybe that's a good book title, Dr. Siri. Is there the one? Okay, while Eleanor focuses on romantic relationships, also any practical advice for implications on building virtuous friendships?
Wait, any advice on how to build virtuous friendships or?
Yeah, how to build virtuous friendships. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, oh no, this is great. So I'm assuming they've all read through this and they know what virtuous friendship is from those earlier chapters, right? You're seeking a good outside of yourself together. So I always use the example, that's what marriage ultimately is. It's the highest form of human virtuous friendship, right? It's not husband and wife like this. Oh, you make me feel so good. And we stare in each other's eyes. This is all lovely. No, real love, my wife and I always say, is like shoulder to shoulder, looking outward to serve something bigger than ourselves, you know, serving God, serving the church, serving. And then if we're blessed with children, then of course our children, right? That's what that is. So, you know, I think that's why I was touching on this a little bit at the very end of finding other people that share your ideals, Catholic ideals, you know, and that's not just I'm Catholic and I go to Mass on Sunday, but where Jesus is the number one thing in your life. You want to find other Christians that are running alongside you and not just the number one thing. It's I'm striving to grow in holiness, that the measure of my Christian life isn't did I go to church on Sunday and am I pro-life? No, you need to do those two things, but the real measure is, am I imitating Jesus? And do I see the gaps in my life? And I'm trying to grow in virtue to imitate Jesus. I am not, there are so many Catholics out there that love theology of the body, or they love young adult group stuff, but they're not running after Jesus. They're not really intentionally trying to get better. I want to look for men that are going to make me better in my life. To this day, I love being, I just had a good conversation with a friend of mine. We're talking about parenting teenagers together and it's helpful. I need iron sharpening my iron as Proverbs 27 says. So that's what we want in life. You want to find other good people that are going to run with you. They're not just mediocre. They are striving for something. Find those other people and they're going to make you better. And that's going to make you better in your marriage.
Awesome. Okay, this one's from Lake. How do you make sure it's not one-sided with the faithfulness? I felt like I was lost in my last relationship and gave more than I was getting. How do you know that balance? How do you make sure that the other person's faithful?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, well, let me say, first of all, in a dating relationship, you know, is different than in marriage, because there are going to be times in marriage when you need to be giving a lot more than the other person. I mean, that happens in any relationship, but especially in marriage. I mean, you could have moments in marriage where your spouse is going through a really hard time, your spouse is really sick. It's for better and for worse, you know, in illness or in health, right? You know, so you just don't know what you're going to, and your spouse may be unfaithful to you and you still have to be faithful. That's what a covenant is. Now, in a dating relationship, you're not quite there yet. And so you don't want to be taken advantage of and all that. So I think, you know, I think that's a good sign when you're noticing, okay, yeah, if it's like, okay, one weekend my girlfriend is sick or is going through a hard time and was a little short with me, I don't worry about that. But if there's a pattern, of selfishness, a pattern of, you know, like not thinking about me and all and just focused on self, that's a sign. That's just revealing something. And yes, you're trying to be a faithful friend, a faithful boyfriend, whatever, but in the end, what's coming out is this other person's character. And that's like a warning sign. So you should be thankful, like, go, thank you, Jesus, that you showed me this now, because it would be a lot harder if I ended up marrying that person, you know, because then that, you know, so be thankful for that. And, you know, as you go into the next relationship, you're using your mind and you're watching this other person's character. And yes, they can be really nice to you at all, but if you start noticing a lot of the selfishness, that's just a sign that they're not the one for you. Okay, you froze again, Jen.
Mike, can you see me?
I can see you now. Yep. Okay, you're unfrozen again. Yeah.
All right. Good. Okay, so what are some true expressions of masculinity and femininity versus the ideals that the culture tries to feed you? What are some true expressions?
I mean, all right, you know, our culture is trying to wipe out masculinity and femininity, like, and which is so sad. You know, and let's be clear about this. We as Catholics, we're going to love people of all different lifestyles, all different backgrounds. We're called to love them, welcome them, be friends with them, pray with them, and as Pope Francis says, and show them a better way. There really is a better way. And we have to be absolutely convicted of this. The Bible is clear. God made us male and female. He did. And JP2 is clear on this. There is a difference between being a man and being a woman. It's not just biological. There's more to this. Like, our souls are made differently. That's the Catholic philosophical background on this. Now, I don't want to get into all that, but I would say the one thing JP2 does say is this. He doesn't offer a lot. It's kind of funny. He says, you know, a woman is attracted to the man's masculinity. And then he puts in parentheses. It doesn't give a lot, but this is what he says, parentheses. His strength. And then it says, and the man is attracted to the woman's femininity, parentheses, her charm. Not a lot there. But I think in 1950s Poland, there wasn't as much, like, you didn't have to define these things as much as we have had to do in more recent decades. The way I think about it is, you know, if I think of the, and again, we want to be careful. We're not trying to stereotype this, but JP2 does say that men are more sensual and women are more sentimental. That doesn't mean women don't have sensuality and doesn't mean men don't have emotions. I think of it as, okay, a woman has, you know, JP2 calls it the feminine genius. You know, like they have an ability to enter into and understand relationships in a more profound way than men do. Doesn't mean men don't, but there's so many times where I walk in, I see two kids fighting, I'm like, okay, stop thinking of it. And my wife will pull me up and say, oh, I think this, just go read the story to this one boy. He just needs a little time right now. I'm like, how do you know this? And my wife just kind of, she intuits things. And so I learned to kind of just go, hey, what do you think? I'll be honest, in the office place, I'll be thinking about, there's certain things, I'm with a bunch of guys, and all of a sudden I'll go ask the girls, hey, what do you think about this? I just want, because I know they will see it from a different angle that's super helpful and will enrich things. So, you know, what does it mean to be masculine? What does it mean to be feminine? I don't want to stereotype it, but I want to start with some of those points JP2 makes. You know, when we think of, he says, okay, there's the masculine strength. You know, maybe you could think of that. Is it chivalry? Is it the man's decisiveness, the man protecting? Is there something about, you know, being a man, that if you look at Jesus in the New Testament, is kind of revealed as the bridegroom, and he's laying down his life for the bride. We're all called to make sacrifices and live self-giving love, but there's a way in which a man is meant to do that in a particular way. And women find that, I think, attractive. So I think there's something beautiful about that. And then I think about the woman, it says her charm, there's this warmth there's of the woman. There's, again, I think of it as this, like, there's this deep emotional connection that they can make with others. That's very beautiful. So I don't want to get into, oh, you wear these kinds of clothes and you do your hair this way. Those are external things. Not that they're not important, but that's not the essence. I think the essence is more what JP2 is talking about.
Yeah. Okay, three more.
That's great.
When would it be okay to let go of friendship or a relationship? What if you feel that the other is not seeking God, but you love them? That's a tough, I know.
So you're in a dating relationship and the other person is not really seeking God. They're not Catholic, or maybe they are Catholic, but they're not going through, they're just going through the motions. What would I say about that? You know, I would say, I talked in the book, in the latter chapters, I interviewed a lot of older couples too. And I interviewed, and in that process, I did interview a number of older couples that were married to people who weren't Catholic. Mm-hmm. And one thing they said was, you know, like, I remember this one woman, I can so remember this woman. She just said, you know, my husband is a great man. He is just a great friend. He's so virtuous. And yet knowing what I know now, I realize I didn't take seriously how much difference of faith makes in a marriage. And it's the greatest source of loneliness and sorrow in my life. Well, and now she loves her husband. Her husband's a really good man, but she can't share that which is most, you know, important to her with him. Now, she was talking about someone who wasn't even Catholic, right? Now, what do you do with, okay, someone's Catholic, maybe, or Christian or Catholic, but they're just not moving in their faith. They're just kind of going through the motions. I think there's something similar there. Like, you love Jesus and it's so important. This other person's just not there. And I would say, if this is a woman especially, I think a woman longs for their husband to lead spiritually. And that man is not going to be able to lead spiritually if he's not leading himself spiritually. So those could be some early signs of maybe that's not there. Maybe there needs to be a serious conversation of, look, I don't want to enforce faith. Everybody's personal faith journey has to be one of their own. But I do want you to know this is really serious to me. And I'm sensing it's just not that important to you. And because of that, I don't think this may work. You know, I can look back in my college days and people I dated, and I can look back at that. I can go, I came to a point of, you know, a very devout, committed, evangelical, Bible-believing, praying Christian, wonderful gal. And she really was just a virtuous, just wonderful girl. But there came a point in going, I'm not going to be able, this isn't going to work. And I just knew it. And it was hard. It was the hardest breakup I probably had, because we really got along well and everything. But that one detail was significant. I remember for a short time dating another Catholic, but it was like this, a Catholic that went to church every Sunday, but that was about it, you know? And there wasn't a lot going on. And I was just like, this isn't going to work, you know? And that might be what's happening here. Please don't take that as break up the relationship today. You know, I pray about it, think about it, but those might be some early signs.
Awesome. Yeah, we talked a lot about that too with Bobby and Jackie and then Father Matthias. And they were talking about, as a woman, it's hard because you want to emasculate a man if you can't be led by him. And so there is something beautiful about being under that mission. If he's completely, you know, sold out for God, you can be under that mission because you're not divided then. Yeah. Okay, here's another one. On the other side of idealization, what do you suggest if we're too critical of the other? So not idealizing, but how do you know when you're just being too critical?
I have a friend of mine that this guy like had the super high ideals, and he was just looking for a woman to fit every one of these boxes, you know, and it was just not, you know, it just wasn't there, you know, And so I don't think he ended up getting married, you know, because he had such high ideals. So you could be so critical. You could be saying, I need to marry the Blessed Virgin Mary. You have to be perfect. You know, well, guess what? There is no, Mary's the only one that was absolutely perfect. You know, she's the only one that was immaculately conceived. And so everyone else is a work in progress. So I think on that end, you want to have ideals and not compromise on certain things. But at the same time, if you know yourself well, you should know how imperfect you are. And your future spouse is going to have to put up with you. So get ready to put up with whatever things are going on in that person's life, because God wants to use marriage to help us all grow in patience and mercy and kindness and forgiveness, you know, because we're both imperfect beings in this sacrament of marriage that's changing us, you know. And so I think if you have too high of standards, you might be being a little too rigid and not human.
Yeah, I love that definition of humility as the truth, knowing the truth about yourself, right?
Yes. Yes. You know, right, the truth about yourself, you'll be more compassionate on your beloved.
And Diana wrote, what do you recommend to strengthen your marriage if your husband or wife is not religious? That's an interesting question. How do you strengthen your marriage if they're not?
Yeah, well, I mean, first of all, don't give up on them not becoming Christian. Like, really be praying for them. Offer sacrifices for them. I think about Saint Monica, constantly was shedding tears for her husband and for her son, and both converted. But she did have a very, you know, hard marriage, and God brought healing in that marriage. And a lot of it, the husband said, was her witness. So pray for them, sacrifice for them. So do some kind of fasting, and like I would, if I was in a situation like that, I would have special prayers I'm doing every day. I'd have special sacrifices every day of my marriage for whatever, how many decades we're married. Because that would be the number one thing I'd want, you know, for them. At the same time, I wouldn't want to be in their face. You need to convert, you know. I would be thinking about Monica, and that's what, you know, Monica was her example that moved her husband more than, she didn't just go, hey, go read this book about the Catholic faith. It was Monica's love, her kindness, her forgiveness, all of that. Really move the husband. And I will tell you, I have heard from many stories of this. I meet a lot of people that have gone through RCAA, and I ask them, so what was it that made you? And, you know, come sometimes they'll say a priest, or was this book I read? A lot of times they will say their spouse. It was the example of their spouse. And I can't tell you how many times I've heard the story where the spouse that was Catholic didn't even know that this was happening on the inside of their spouse. And the spouse secretly goes to RCAA. And then the husband or wife finds out about it later. You're a nurse. What? You know, like the spouse says, hey, I wanted to tell you, I've been going to RCAA. Would you come with me? And then it's like this great joy. So you never know what's really going on inside them. So pray for them, sacrifice for them. And your witness, your kindness, your example, not nagging them, you know, I think is important. Don't ever give up on that. Now, that being said, what are you doing in the meantime? You know, just like you would with any good friend, you're enriching the relationship. You're taking time for the relationship with each other. You're taking time to listen to your spouse. You know, all the things that you would normally do in any other marriage, you can still do, you know, and then keep working on the hopeful spiritual conversion as well.
All right, Dr. Sri, last two. What are the applications of love and responsibility for those called to celibacy?
For those called to celibacy. So this must be one of the priests asking, is this it?
Or someone
that might be thinking of marriage. Okay. Well, in any case, I'll tell you, I have done classes on theology of the body for priests, for religious, for sisters. This is crazy. I'm going to tell you a fun story. I was invited to do I do a lot of teaching with the Missionaries of Charity for some of the different regions. And I was once, about 10 years ago, invited to do a retreat for them on theology of the body. And I remember this sister on the phone telling me this. It was really kind of funny. She just says, now, Dr. Sri, so we really want you to get into theology of the body because we know our vocation is to marry, you know, we view ourselves as spouses of Christ. This is Mother Teresa's order, right? Yeah. You know, beautiful, holy sisters serving the poorest of the poor, and we are spouses of Christ. So we know that we want to learn more about what human marriage is like so we can understand our role as spouses of Jesus. So I know theology of the body gets into marriage and sexuality and love between husband and wife, and we want you to be as explicit as possible. And I'm like, that feels a little weird, sister. But we did it, you know, and we talked a lot about this, even some things related to sexuality. And but it is beautiful. So how did some of these things apply? So one example, I remember the sisters telling me this, and I've heard the same thing from priests as well. You know, this idealization. Like you could just think, oh, that just happens with young people when they're falling in love. No, it can happen to a married couple. You could be married 20 years and there's tension going on with you and your spouse. And then you meet this other person at the parish, this other person at work, and there's nothing sexual going on, but you can just start thinking, oh, this woman would appreciate me more. This person would understand. This person sees, you know, and you're just idealizing. You don't really know this other person. It would just be as messy with them as it is with your spouse. So get over it, right? So that happens. Same with priests and religious sisters. You know, I gave the example that religious sisters could, you know, easily just start, you know, they meet some lay person or some priest and they can start idealizing some life with them. And I said that, and these sisters came up afterwards going, that happens. That happens all the time. There's volunteers that come and the sisters will start have this emotional attraction to this attractive man that's volunteering. And they start questioning their vocation and like this, oh my goodness, is this a crisis? Did I do the right vocation? I have feelings for someone else. And you're like, and they have to be taught, no, that's normal. It's good that you have feelings for the opposite sex. That's really, really good. Now, what you do with those feelings is different. You don't want to idealize. And religious and priests can easily fall into, that's often the first step towards some kind of infidelity to their vocation, is it usually isn't just like, oh, I'm going to go find some prostitute. That happens, sadly. But often it is more just, you know, I developed this emotional connection with someone and I started to idealize how wonderful they are. And that's what led to greater problems. So the same thing can happen in a marriage could happen in a religious vocation.
Oh, thank you so much. All right. So last, we totally agree with you about virtue and growing in virtue. I remember a friend just asked me, Jen, how do I, you know, have a virtuous friendship? I'm like, well, it starts with just having virtue, you know, even before the friendship. So yep. How can we grow? Someone asked, how can we grow in virtue, Dr. Sri? This would be all right. The last.
Yes. Okay. So before I take that last question, can I ask you all a question? Because I have a whole chapter on this in the new book I'm writing that is due by January 4th. And I'm about 3/4 of the way done. And I'm going to be over the Christmas break kind of doing my last review. Can I ask you all, since you asked a lot about virtue, if you remember, could you say a Hail Mary for this book project? It's something I've been thinking about and teaching about for about 15, almost 20 years. And I know it really connects with people. And I want to make sure the book, just pray that whatever the Holy Spirit wants for the book, it's there to touch souls, to give them a vision for the virtuous life, to inspire them to live virtue in their own life, but then in their friendship. So if you all remember Hail Mary for that, I would be grateful that it helps souls. Now, I have a whole chapter on how do you grow in virtue? And I'll tell you, this is what we talked about. These aren't my ideas. I'm drawing on the great thinkers like Thomas Aquinas, JP2, and Aristotle. In this case, I'm drawing right from the catechism. You can just open up the catechism. How do you grow in virtue? And it tells you 3 things you need to do. First, you have to educate yourself in the virtues. You got to learn about the virtues. If you don't really know what the virtues are, you're never going to grow in them, you know? So I'm not really going to grow in generosity unless I'm actually trying to form my mind to understand what does generosity really look like. So how do I grow in virtue? I already mentioned that book by Donald DeMarco. I meant you could read Aquinas and Aristotle if you're really a go-getter. I've got those free articles that are easy to read on my website that are there. But I think one of the best ways to grow in virtue, honestly, is reading the lives of the saints. The saints aren't, it's good to read about what the virtues are. But when you read the lives of the saints, you're just inspired. You're just inspired by their heroism. You're just going, this, you know, their example. And you just see, you know, how did Saint Therese deal with people in the convent that really annoyed her? You know, when people annoy me, I tend to go like, oh, I don't want to be around them. Therese actually went out of her way to go love them. That's virtuous. She spent extra time with the people that annoyed her the most. That's just counterculture. That's rising above your feelings. That's what Therese says. Love is rising above your feelings. and doing what's good for others. And that's what she did. You know, when you read something about, you know, St. Jose Maria Escrivá, who's offering up his work, any work he does, he offers it up, unites it to Jesus and offers it for other souls. You get a vision. Oh, I'm at work, but I can make my work a little temple, a little tabernacle. When I log on, I just say a short prayer. Jesus, I offer this work today for my friend, you know, what he's going through right now. So like you learn something from the saints. You know, today I was just with a session. It was an amazing session of two men that have struggled with SSA, you know, and have gotten counseling and healing. And they just were talking all about, you know, just inspiring. They're talking about virtue. They're talking about how, you know, so much in our culture today tells us when you struggle with some kind of sexual addiction or something, it's just like, oh, it's just so hard. It's hard. It's so hard. And then they're like, no, that's not the full story. As Christians, we believe there's grace and grace helps us. And yes, it's hard, but you're not alone. And Jesus is going to give you the strength. So buck up, let's go. We can do it. And we found healing. You can find it too. I mean, they were like, and totally inspiring this group of people on an online meeting I was in earlier today. But when you're around virtuous people like that, or you're reading about the virtuous saints, you're educating yourself in the vision. That I think that's one of the key things. Surround yourself with virtuous people and read about the virtues, read about the saints. Step one. Step two, you got to practice. You can't just read about virtue. Oh, I read a book about virtue and my holy hour was great. No, it's Catherine of Siena says, virtue is conceived in prayer, but it's born in your neighbor. You got to actually put into practice with the people right around you. So it's one thing to say, oh, I'm so inspired about Therese and how she went out. Isn't that beautiful? Now, when you find yourself in a gathering at the office and there's that coworker that's really difficult to be with, are you going to go out of your way to go love that person? You know, or when I can, you know, I can deny myself in some way and serve someone else or hold back when everyone's gossiping in the office, can I turn the conversation away from the gossip and just change the topic? Am I trying to live virtue? I have to practice it. I got to be really intentional, especially one of the best ways to practice virtue is to think about your weaknesses. What am I weak in? I'm vain. I worry too much about what other people think of me. I always worry, did I leave a good impression? What are they thinking of me? Do they like me? If I'm worried about that, I need to go against that. I need to fight against that. I don't fight against that by saying, oh, I'm not going to be vain anymore. I fight against that by purposely doing things that get me not to do this. So in other words, rather than just say, I'm not going to be vain, I'll just say, you know, I'm going to just give that report and not ask anyone, oh, what did you think? You know, did you like it? I'm just going to do my work at the office and, you know, not going to worry. I'll tend to worry, but I'm going to purposely try not to do things that draw attention to myself or where I'm worried about other people think. Or maybe I talk too much. I dominate conversation. So what I'm going to do is when I'm with my friends, I'm going to just, instead of me talking, say, hey, what did you think? And practice listening to others. I practice other virtues that counter my weakness. If I always like to do what I want all the time and I'm with my friends, instead of me deciding where we're going to go out to eat or what movie we're going to watch, I say, what do you all want to do? And now I'm purposely going against the vices I tend to struggle with. So practice. So educate yourself, practice. And the last one is grace. And no matter how much you study the virtues up here, no matter how much you use your will to try to do better, you know what's going to happen? You're going to run up against weakness and you're going to realize how much you need God's grace to help you overcome those sins, those vices, that inner healing. That's what God wants to do. That's the real healing he wants to do in all of our souls. And we grow in grace through prayer, begging for grace through the sacraments. So those are the three things.
Awesome. Thank you. It has been such a blessing these last couple months for us in these discussions, a small group. It has been wonderful. And we are just blessed by your gift of writing. Where can they find your book if some of the people just came on to listen? Where can they find your book?
Yeah, so the book is called Men, Women, the Mystery of Love. You can go to my website, which is just my name, edwardsri.com, edwardsri.com. You can check it out there. I'd also say on my podcast, so I do a podcast every Tuesday. It's called All Things Catholic with Edward Sri. And I've done a number of podcasts on topics related to marriage, dating relationships. In fact, I think just last January, so January 2020, pre-COVID, Right after the SEEK conference, I remember I did a couple episodes just on this topic of men, women, mystery, love. So you can check out my podcast. If you were to go to to your phone, to Apple Podcasts or Spotify or whatever, I'm going to give you one word of advice because people have told me this. You can't just search for my last name, SRI. If you just type in on Spotify or Apple Podcasts, SRI, you will not find me. You will find an Indian Hindu guru. And I want you to know I'm not the Indian Hindu guru guy. You got to type in Edward. Edward SRI, and then you'll find my podcast. You can subscribe there and you can hear talks about this topic as well.
Awesome. Well, we look forward to having you. We're going to be having another webinar, everyone, in February, just like we did in the summer. So we're hoping to have some Normantines, a sister of life, and maybe Edward Sri and his wife. We'll see what's going to happen with that. And then we'll do marriage and then also hopefully a webinar on virtuous friendship. We are so thankful for you guys. This is all recorded on Facebook at Love and Responsibility LA and Instagram. So please go there and you're able to watch it or send it to a friend. You have been a great blessing and we do pray for your new book. We pray that Blessed Mother will just have her intercession and the Holy Spirit will guide you and protect you and your wife and family. So thank you so much, Dr. Sri.
You're so kind, Jen. Thank you for having me. And I'll just want to say to everybody else, if you have any questions too, I know we ran out of time here, but feel free to reach out to me on Instagram or Facebook, Twitter, whatever. You can find me there and send me questions and I can follow up afterwards as well. So thank you for having me. God bless your ministry. And definitely, I know my wife will want to join us if it works out. So we'd love to do it.
Sounds good. All right, everyone. So we'll see you next time. Don't forget, love responsibly.